Well, today's message is accepting God. For the season of Advent, we started with longing for God, then we had thirsting for God, and then we had waiting on God, and we complete the Advent season with accepting God. We long for, we thirst for God, and after all of that longing and thirsting and waiting for God, we may or may not accept God. We humans are funny, and that sometimes when we actually receive what we have been longing for, we are underwhelmed. When I was in third grade, I longed for a watch. I thought watches were the absolute coolest things, and I begged my parents for a watch and did not receive one. And I begged both sets of my grandparents for a watch. And lo and behold, on Christmas Day in 1977, I received a maroon watch from one set of grandparents and a green watch from the other set of grandparents. And there's a Polaroid photo of me somewhere. And I'm holding up both of my arms, both with watches wrapped around my wrists. And what I was longing for came to me in abundance. And I lost interest really quite quickly. And I lost one of the watches quite quickly. When we are finally provided that which we are longing for, we may just move on to the next longing. And for my 8-year-old self, it was a better bicycle. We long to get a promotion at work. And one day, we finally get promoted, and we find that it doesn't meet our expectations. We long to get a new home, a new car. We may long to enter into a new relationship. All of these things we thirst for, and upon receiving these new things, we may find an emptiness continues in our lives because we have put all these things before God. However, it's never too late. It's never, ever too late to accept God and then let the rest follow. The self-esteem movement in the United States has been about getting people to accept themselves. And that's a good thing, but it's not the main concern of people of faith. Our main concern is not accepting ourselves, but accepting God. Self-acceptance with all of our stumbles and failures and sins, again, that's a good thing, but even more important is accepting God's love, accepting God's forgiveness, accepting God's joy, accepting God's grace, accepting God's challenges. As Christians, we are called on to accept ourselves and accept people as they are, but we are also to deeply desire our own spiritual growth as well as the spiritual growth of others. We want to be able to say, I am not what I once was. I'm not what I once was. Each of us, year after year, we want to be able to say those words, I am not what I once was. As we accept more of God into our lives, we have to transform, we have to grow, and we are no longer the person we were previously. But I think we also have to be careful of our observations of others. I make it a point not to tell others that you've really grown in this or that way. It could be that I'm the one who's grown in observing a change in another person that's been there all along. And I may be slow in recognizing a transformation, so I found it better and safer to be humble and focus instead on asking what God's been doing in the person's life rather than relying only on my own observations. And I believe, an aside here very quickly. We are live streaming the service, and I'm guessing that you want me to stay centered. Is that an issue? Yes. Okay. So I will stay centered rather than wandering around. So accepting God and accepting God's wisdom, accepting God's leading in our lives means that we need not rely on the acceptance of others. And let's face it, some people may never accept us. Praise be to God that we do not live for the acceptance of others. Our lives are instead about accepting God and recognizing that long before our acceptance of God, we are already God's own. Now, some here grew up in evangelical households where decisional theology was important. A person made a decision to accept Christ. Yet before we make a decision, it's important to realize that God already made the decision to have us as God's own. Our decision is a response to God rather than initiating that response, initiating that relationship with God. So a faith life, a spiritual journey, even an inner generous outreach to us. And because we live in a culture that insists that people do things by their own power, because we live in a culture that believes everything starts with us, we often get caught up in this kind of thinking. We apply it to our spiritual lives. We think we have to do and do and do in order to prove ourselves to God, that we have to start something with God in order to have a faith journey, but it is God first who got a hold of us and never lets us go. God has been all in since before we were even born. God made us, molded us, knit us together in our mother's womb. The book of Proverbs is full of practical wisdom. And I think some of the best verses in Proverbs are found in chapter 3, which was our first passage today. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not rely on your own insight. In all your ways, acknowledge the Lord, and the Lord will make clear your paths. Now, there are some corners of Christianity where they want us to stop thinking for ourselves and accept whatever teaching or actions are coming from church leaders. And this is what I call the church gone rogue. And it's not a good thing, the church gone rogue. And it's resulted in scandals in a number of denominations, from the Roman Catholics to evangelicals. Now, that verse from Proverbs, notice that it does not say, trust the church with all your heart. Notice that verse from Proverbs does not say, trust the bishop or the pastor with all your heart. It doesn't say, trust in the deacons or board or staff with all your heart. What does it say? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. These verses from Proverbs are not about us setting our brains to the side when we enter into the church doors. God has very high expectations for individual Christians, that we each develop a solid trust in God, a confidence in God's presence and God's power. These verses from Proverbs are all about letting our minds be filled with God. Now, instead of putting all of our trust in ourselves, instead of putting all of our trust in our thoughts and our opinions and what we believe to be our trusty internet searches, in the spiritual life, we enter into the grand adventure of trusting God. And it is a very, very, very different way of living, isn't it? Instead of putting all of our trust in ourselves, or trusting the internet, or trusting whatever feels right, well, it's different when we put our trust first and foremost in God. When we trust in God and lean not on our own understanding, we step out into the unknown, the wild, the untamable time with God. And then what happens? Well, we grow. We grow in wisdom beyond our imagining. The passage today from Paul's letter to the Romans is difficult passage for Christians with a more progressive approach. A first response to the passage may be, yikes, because this passage, right, baby? Right? Our response to this passage from Paul may be, yikes, because it's full of so many loaded words, like sin and righteousness and death and sanctification. Do we really want to take a look at this passage today? Just briefly. Just a few moments. Paul makes it very clear to the church in Rome, and Paul makes it very clear to us, that the end of sin is death. It's nothingness. Well, what's sin? Remember, sin is separation from God. It's going our own way. And for Paul, in going our own way, we die. But those who put sin aside and accept God's leading, there is no death, only eternal life. Paul writes that when the Romans are freed from sin through their commitment to Christ, when they are freed from sin, the advantage they get is sanctification. The Roman church members are sanctified. What does this mean? To be sanctified is to be made holy, is to be set apart for God. Another way of thinking of sanctification is to think of people being transformed. And of course, Paul isn't just writing to the Roman church. His letter is a part of the New Testament. It's sacred scripture, and it speaks to us today. We here at MCCLV, we are freed from sin through our commitment to Christ, and in this freedom from sin, we are transformed. And we all sin and fall short of the glory of God all the time. Yet as we grow in Christ, as we accept God's love, as we accept God's grace more and more in our lives, our sins, our separation from God is lessened, we are transformed or sanctified, and we are more and more about God. We are more and more set apart for God. We become less concerned with pursuing happiness, and we become more concerned with what? Pursuing holiness. Paul ends his passage by writing, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." The free gift from God is not stuff. not more things that we do not need, but eternal life in Christ. Eternal life in Christ. That is a mighty big gift from God. Accepting eternal life is not like accepting a lifetime achievement award, or it's not some sort of reward for doing good things. Again, the spiritual life is a very, very different kind of life. Paul writes that the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal life in Christ. What does that mean? Eternal life in Christ. Oh, eternal life is in Christ and not in our accomplishments. Praise be to God, and few, right? Eternal life is not in how many lives we have positively impacted or how many people we have evangelized. Praise be to God, right? Few. Eternal life is not in how good we are. Praise be to God. Eternal life is about how good God is. Eternal life is not in orientation, right? Orientation of heterosexual, bisexual, gay, or lesbian, right? Praise be to God. But eternal life is about an orientation to Christ, being oriented to Christ, directing our attention and our hearts toward Christ. Eternal life is in Christ, in accepting Christ as the Lord of our lives, our Savior, and our healer. In that last scripture passage today from Matthew's Gospel, we have Jesus' beautiful, compelling, and comforting words. What does Jesus say? Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Again, we are invited into a very, very different kind of life. These readings from Proverbs, Romans, and Matthew, they're all striking in how they call us away from a life that's about accepting what the world wants. And these readings, they point us toward accepting a life that's more about what God wants. And in Matthew, Jesus promises rest for his followers. If there is ever a time of year when we are in need of rest, it is around the holidays with so much rushing. Amen? Yes. The pressures of the holidays mean that not only is physical rest needed, but also that rest for our souls. And we find that soul rest not primarily in a day off or in vacation. We find true soul rest in Christ, in turning to Christ, in accepting Christ's direction. In his work titled Confessions, St. Augustine wrote this: "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it finds rest in you." The Christ-led life is not some sort of huge, gigantic undertaking, but it is a new way of thinking and being and doing. Jesus says that his yoke is easy, his burden light. What's a yoke? Well, a yoke is a frame, and it joins the heads of two animals so they can work together. And then the two animals are more powerful than just one working alone. In accepting the invitation to be yoked with Jesus, we are accepting the invitation to not be so alone. We have a forever friend and Savior who walks with us, who lightens the load, eases our burdens. The one we long for has been with us all along. God is with us, and as we more and more accept God's presence in our lives, the more things balance out and we sense more peace in our lives. This season has the potential to wear us down with all of its money pressures, the forced holiday cheeriness pressures. A lot of us, we want this season to be more about Christ, but we're not quite sure how to do that. Well, one simple switch we may make is instead of calling these days holidays, we start calling them holy days, right? They are originally holy days. Another thing we could do is to take a step into that unknown, wild world of time with God. And when we take this step into this wild world, it might be scary at first to do something this different, to really lean on the Lord and not on our own understanding. Maybe it's reaching out to someone who's alone during these holy days, inviting them to a celebration. Maybe a little awkward, but some things are worth a little awkwardness. If the end result is glorifying God, when we accept another into our lives, we're accepting God. And there's definitely a loneliness epidemic in the world right now. Now, there are are other wild things that could happen if we step into this adventure with God. Extravagant generosity, amazing grace, deep mercy. As we grow in acceptance of God's calling on our lives, wonders and miracles make appearances in our lives. There's a quotation that's often attributed to the author Joseph Campbell. And while it's not an exact quote, it's based on his writing, and it's this. We must let go of the life we have planned so as to accept the life that is waiting for us. Again, we must let go of the life we have planned so as to accept the life that is waiting for us. The spiritual journey is not the life we have planned. God has something different and richer for us. And as we turn more in God's direction, as we move more toward accepting the life that God has planned for us, we discover more of that richness. Tonight, we celebrate the birth of a Savior. God made flesh, an unplanned pregnancy, and the acceptance of it all by some ordinary shepherds. It is the ultimate and wild adventure with God. And praise God for the opportunity to step into this adventure with God during these holy days. And so let us pray. Loving God, grow us in accepting you and accepting your leadership over our lives. Help us, O God, to more fully receive your gifts and your graces that we may glorify having arrived so closely now to